Good Sunday morning, everybody. With all due respect, no matter what you have planned for today, you ought to take time, change your schedule a little bit, go visit the Museum of African American Art in the Baldwin Hills Crenshaw Plaza from 2 to 4 this afternoon, because there's a very important photo exhibit that opens this afternoon. It is called, very provocatively, My Choice of Weapons Through the Lens. And the photographer is our guest today, Haywood Galbreath. Welcome to Midday.
Thank you, sir.
What did you come up with that title?
Actually, it's part of it's from one of the titles of one of Garden Parks' books.
Oh, of course, one of the great African American. Well, he's a great photographer, regardless of the color of his skin.
Yes, and when I moved to Florida, he was my inspiration for becoming a photojournalist. Mm-hmm. One part of my inspiration, and when I moved to Florida, I checked his book out of the library, My Choice of Weapons, and I read it, and mm-hmm. it's so interesting to me. His life and my life have so many parallels, mm-hmm. and so he really became more of an inspiration to me. And when I was thinking about my photo exhibit and my life and my career, I decided to say My Choice of Weapons Through the Lens, and the other part is History and Moments Captured. Mm-hmm. I had a choice of weapons in life, and I chose the camera as my weapon.
Yeah, it is a powerful one. There's a total of about 60 images that are part of the exhibit.
I think 62.
62, and we're going to talk about as many as we can squeeze in, but about 10. And the very first one is an electrifying, dramatic beyond words. There's a perfect example of a picture is worth a thousand words. That was shot where?
That was shot in Hollandale, Florida. When I started my career in Florida, only thing I could do, because I wasn't working for a newspaper and I really wanted to get into the business, I had started at WSVN7 as a sound tech, and I used to carry my camera with me all the time. And when we'd go out on shoots, stories, most especially breaking news, I would try to shoot it and sell it to the newspapers. Well, for about 6 months, nobody really, they didn't pay attention. But then one day I sold an image, and my first image I sold went all over the world. And then when I would call the newspaper, they no longer asked who I was. They would say, what you got?
Yeah.
And on this particular day, I used to listen to the scanners all the time. I had about 5 scanners. I listened to the scanners, and I heard about an accident in
Holland. It's the police and fire radios.
Yes. And so I went to the scene, and there was this young man laying out there, deceased. And I was shooting, and his father came to the scene. Mm-hmm. And his father, I believe, owned a garage. And he came, and he looked at the body, and he pulled back the cover, and he laid down on his son.
Yeah.
And he was crying, and it was very emotional. And as you probably know, I got the camera clicking, and people are looking at me, and the law enforcement is looking at me like I don't have any compassion. But the biggest thing about it was he was talking to his son, and he was rubbing his son, and he was saying, I told you this Jeep was going to get you killed. I told you to be careful. And at the time, it didn't really affect me, because, you know, we get in the zone and we do what we
do. Sure. Which, and to a large degree, that's self-protection.
Yes. But once I got through and went home and processed the film and got it to the paper, then reality set in, and I started thinking about it. And actually, for about 2 months, I didn't go back out and shoot stuff. It just bothered me. Mm-hmm. And if you would ask me what is my most memorable image that I've captured in 29 years, I would say it's the image of the father mm-hmm. crying over his son's body and talking to him. And there's a sequence that's one image, but there's a sequence that's going to be in the exhibit about the father's emotion.
Let's take a look at another one of the photographs. This one will be, there we are.
Yes.
Different context, different kind of photo, but still very dramatic.
Yes, that was, growing up, you hear about different American, for me, different African-American heroes. Mm-hmm. And part of my life was I wanted to meet those individuals. Mm-hmm. And so Congresswoman Maxine Waters had been elected to Congress, and they was having her swearing in, and I think it was the same time that President Clinton had been elected mm-hmm. also. So went to Washington, D.C. to cover the swearing in of Congresswoman Waters and President Clinton. And Justice Thurgood Marshall was going to do the swearing in, and he was swearing in all the new members of the Congressional Black Caucus, and it was like about 15 or 20 of them.
And that's Justice Marshall on the right.
That's Justice Marshall on the right. And Bill Cosby was there, I guess, as a celebrity person. And Justice Marshall was having cataract problems and problems with his eyes, and he couldn't stand a lot of flash and stuff. And so we were flashing, and all of a sudden, and Bill Cosby had said, you know, the flashes are bothering the justice, but they couldn't stop what was going on. So all of a sudden, he had a folder in his hand, and he just picked it up and put it over the justice's eyes. And what caught me as most interesting was once he did that, he was looking out from up under his armpit, and at that moment, I snapped a picture.
Yeah. Now, you've got with you here, you've got a cannon, a big cannon.
This is, you know, men and their toys.
Yes, yes.
Men and their toys. This is my cannon.
The reason I wanted you to show it is that you can have about a $12,000 rig there.
This one.
It doesn't matter what you got. It's this that takes the picture. It's this that sees the picture.
It's the eye. You know, and gratefully, others say it. I don't see it so much, but others say you have an eye for what you're doing. Mm. I used to work at the Los Angeles Sentinel, which is actually where I got started, mm-hmm. the Los Angeles Sentinel, mm-hmm. one of our African-American newspapers right. here in Los Angeles. Right. And people started coming up to me on the street and saying, I saw your picture. They forgot to put your name on it, but I know it's your picture. And they would explain the picture, and I would say, yeah, that's my image. Mm-hmm. And they say, we knew it was because you have a certain way you shoot, yeah. and we can tell yours from anybody yeah, else. Yeah, and yeah. made me feel yeah. quite
It's very true, good. Very true. We've got another image here. We'll see if we can identify there. Oh, yeah, of course.
Hey.
We've been telling you about this important photo exhibit. It opens today at 2 o'clock at the Museum of African American Art. And it is at the, it's up on the third floor of the Macy's building at the Baldwin Hills Crenshaw Plaza. That's at the corner of Crenshaw and Martin Luther King. You need to go there. You need to see it. We've got two places where you can get additional information about what's going on. The first of them is the Museum of African American Art's own website, which is at www.maaala.org. And then there is Haywood's, I'm thinking of Howard Bingham, who was the other great photographer. Haywood's website is www.mpji.org. We'll have those again later in this newscast if you want to take a look at them. Or you can go to our website, which is myfoxla.com. Stand by. We'll be right back. Photojournalist Haywood Galbreath is our guest today. He's got this wonderful exhibit that opens this afternoon at the Museum of African American Art at the Crenshaw Baldwin Hills Plaza. We'll have all of those details for you in a minute. We were talking about the photograph with Coretta Scott King and the family, and you're going to be at the opening this afternoon.
Yes.
So, and as you can tell, Haywood's got a story about every one of his photographs. So people, you can elaborate about that. What I want to do is show some more photographs,
okay.
if we may. So let's take a look at what we've got queued up next, which there, you are extraordinarily famous for this photograph and all that it represents.
Yes, sir. You know, that was the trial of the century. As a matter of fact, that was the media event of the century, hands down, on anything else that took place. The black press quite often has to struggle to get to cover events. The bigger the event, the harder it is. So I fought and advocated for the black press to have a place in the courtroom, which I fight for us to have a place anytime anything is taking place, but especially when it involves people of color. And so the judge, Judge Ito, decided that we should have a place in the courtroom. And for the first time in history, an African-American-owned news photo service was able to be in a court of that magnitude, court case of that magnitude. And so one of the days during the preliminaries, we were shooting, and Mr. Cochran was at the podium talking to the judge, and a question came up from the judge, I believe, and Mr. Cochran said, excuse me a minute, Judge, I need to talk to my client. And he walked over and he leaned down. And as he leaned down, OJ turned to speak to him. And then Bob Shapiro was sitting right there. And all of a sudden, Bob Shapiro went. And as soon as Bob Shapiro did that, I said, E.F. Hutton, click, click, click. Yeah. You remember the famous E.F. Hutton commercial when E.F. Hutton, everybody listens and people start leaning. So Bob leaning in just, that was the moment right there when Bob leaned in. E.F. Hutton, click, click, click. And they wound up using that particular image on O.J.'s book, I Want to Tell You.
It goes back to the question that we were talking about earlier, the decisive moment. And so often our ability to recognize a decisive moment, whether it's in something as serious as photojournalism or just taking a picture of your family, so much of our ability to recognize that moment comes from all of the things that we have experienced in life up to that moment, no?
Yes. You know, I always tell people, we are the sum total of our life's experiences. If your life's experiences have been very negative, you're going to be a very negative person. If they've been very positive, you're going to be very positive. If people have treated you bad, you're going to look at people as negatively. If they've treated you good, you're going to look at them positively. And so, as you said, our life experiences, what we see, like I said, for instance, the decisive moment in that photo came from me having seen a commercial about something. And quite often in other images that I take, it's something that I've seen, perhaps an image that I saw of another photographer or something, or something that I'd seen on television or something. So yes, or another scene that I'd seen in life and getting a chance to capture that moment.
Let's see another photograph.
Super Bowl.
Yep.
Brett Favre.
Yep.
San Diego. I got some issues with Brett Favre in that Super Bowl, but I'll let it go. And what's so interesting about that image, I have another image of a Green Bay Packer but a Denver Bronco stiff-arming a Green Bay Packer that knocked him off his feet. And then we have Brett Favre stiff-arming to the face the Denver Bronco, and it was very interesting to get two stiff-arm photos in that particular game. And like I said, you know, the Super Bowl is the largest event, and it's always been a pleasure to be there. Yes, once again, I have to fight to get there, but it's all worthwhile. The fight has always been worthwhile.
Sure, and you're fighting not just for yourself, but all of us who are have the pleasure of looking at your images.
Well, thank you very much.
Let's flip the switch and do another one here.
The mayor.
Our soon-to-be former mayor.
Yes, sir.
Antonio Villaraigosa.
Once again, the decisive moment. Shot several images of him speaking and others speaking, but the decisive moment and the one I remember the most is when he, with fatherly love, leaned over to kiss his son. And the expression on his son's face and his former wife's face was just timeless and so endearing. And, you know, you can look at that and say and see that there was a lot of love there. And that was the decisive.
It's another side of the typical elected official. They're hard-nosed, they're combative, but then there's the moment of tenderness.
There's that moment.
Boy, oh boy, the opportunities, how fortunate you have been to be able to see those. And here, another internationally recognizable face.
Michael Jackson. Once again, growing up, I remember when I was in Florida, they had the 25th anniversary of Motown. That was when Michael first debuted in Moonwalk, and I turned around to everybody in the room and I said, you know, one day, I'm gonna meet Michael Jackson. I'm gonna meet all those people. I am going to be a photographer and an actor, and I'm going to meet all those people. And when I came to LA, I had the opportunity to cover Michael on several things. And this particular occasion was a sad occasion because it was the funeral of Johnny Cochran. But I was able, and it was very difficult positioning and getting a position, but I was able to get that good image of Michael smiling and waving. And now it's even more important since, you know, Michael passed away a few years ago.
I would imagine that you have a lot of unpublished images of him.
I I have several unpublished images of Michael. You know, another nice image is when he performed at the Super Bowl in Pasadena. Mm-hmm. And so it means a lot to me. Yes, I have several.
I suspect that the next step is a book. Photographs.
Well, I'm thinking about, I have enough images. The images in the photo exhibit just barely scratched the surface of what I have, and I had to go through them, and I didn't really get to go through all of them. I suppose I have enough images for about four or five books.
There you are. Let's take a look at another one.
President Obama. What can I say about President Obama? I'll say this much. Okay, I admit that when he started running, I thought he had about as much chance of becoming president as a gas truck going through a fire. Mm-hmm. But, I will admit, folks, I was wrong. I was wrong. And he became president, and I had the privilege of being one of his photographers in California when he was running. And when he was elected, his first trip back, he flew into Long Beach. And I went to Long Beach and captured that famous walk off the plane wave. Mm-hmm. And it's a photo that's very dear to me, capturing that photo of him walking off the plane as president. Mm-hmm. And I actually have a letter from him thanking me for being his photographer.
That's wonderful. I think that was the last of the photographs that we have, I believe. Though there's one more. Let's take a look at that so we can say that we have shown them all to you. Ah, what a day that was in South Los Angeles, huh?
What a day. I started out early, went to the airport as they started taking it on its journey. You know, the shuttle's final journey was sentimental to me. I started with the shuttle in Miami when the first shuttle exploded. I went to cover the recovery and everything, so I got into the shuttles and I always have enjoyed the shuttles. And so this was very sentimental to me to cover the last shuttle's journey. And once again, I had to rip and run, and so many people were out there and to try to find a place and to capture that particular moment. And the moment for me was when it crossed the 405 at night and they were going to shut down the 405. Yeah. And so I got positioned and the shuttle crossed the 405 and I captured the moment. And I didn't think about it at the time, but when I went home and looked at the images, a tear came to my eye because it was the end of an era.
Not only that, but that with the freeway underneath, that's the quintessential moment for the space shuttle and for Southern California. You know, nothing says Southern California like that.
Yeah, you know, the freeway shut down. How many times have you really ever seen something shut the freeway down except an accident?
Yeah, just an amazing shot, and the exposure is absolutely right. And we got to take another break.
Thank you.
Let's do that.